Welcome back to the 40th part of Debugging at Scale, where we delve into the browser and its fantastic capabilities. Instead of printing the stack trace, one of the neat tricks in JavaScript is instant debugging. Just use the debugger keyword to launch the debugger on that line. If you have an error handling method, it would be an ideal place for that call. This is probably not something we'd like to leave in a production environment, but it can be very useful in a debug version of your site, assuming you have a preprocessor that can remove that call for production. We can trigger the debugging of a function directly from the console. For instance, this code in the console would trigger the debugger when the last line is invoked. The debug hello statement adds a breakpoint into the hello function. When we invoke the function in the last line, we'll send directly into the debugger. DOM breakpoints are a powerful feature in Chrome. Think of them as the field watchpoints of the browser. We can place a breakpoint that we will hit when a specific area of the DOM is mutated. This only works for Chrome and Firebug, which is a Firefox plugin. But this is easy to use. Just right-click the DOM and select Break On, followed by the behavior that you're interested in. Notice that this is in addition to conditional breakpoints and line breakpoint capabilities. Both capabilities are supported by all major browser development tools. Browsers have some amazing HTTP traffic monitoring capabilities that let us inspect all the outgoing requests and responses in detail. These are fantastic capabilities that I use often. They show every request as a set of bars indicating the time, size, and all the technical information, body, headers, etc. They're missing one crucial piece: the culprit. Who made the specific request? This is often trivial to find. We can search for the URI, but in some cases, the URI might be assembled dynamically or might arrive from multiple sources, and the flow is unclear. For these cases, we have the XHR breakpoint, which we can set in Chrome or Firebug by defining a substring of the URI that we wish to break on. When a request arrives to fetch that URI, Chrome will hit that breakpoint and stop the execution of the script. Here we have the XHR breakpoint area in Chrome. It's located in the Sources tab under the call stack. Notice that if we don't fill in the URL filter, an XHR breakpoint is set for any XHR request, which might get noisy. When debugging hard-to-reproduce issues, a common technique is to spoof or simulate the problematic environment. These are some techniques we can use to simulate such an environment. Since debugging on a mobile device is a bit more challenging, it's often easier to simulate some behaviors that are more common there in our desktop browser. The override section within Chrome settings lets you spoof functionality within the browser, specifically the browser user agent. Simulating a different user agent can help us isolate browser or OS specific issues that might be triggered because of server-side platform-specific content. This can be customized in Chrome in the settings section. For Firefox, you will need to install an extension to accomplish the same. You can use a database to find the user agent you wish to spoof, but I find it simpler to look at the user agents submitted from the browser where the code is working. You can inspect headers received in the failed server requests and then try using the same user agent in another browser. We can also spoof the geographic location of the browser instance to get locale-specific functionality and debug that. Touch behavior, which is useful for debugging device functionality on a desktop, touch gestures might produce different behavior when compared to typical events. You can select emulate touch events in the override options in Firefox. If you're in the responsive design view, you could emulate a touch event. The same is true for device orientation, which can also be spoofed to debug various edge cases. Layout and style bugs typically stand out on their own and are typically separate from the full stack issues. However, since we're discussing frontends so extensively, it makes sense to cover these issues as well. The inspect element view of the developer tools is possibly the most important feature within them. It's the default view and the starting point for most front-end work, as we can see here on for Firefox. Notice that at first glance, Firefox might seem more functional than Chrome, which you can see here. Chrome hides some of the features behind additional tabs, which has some benefits and some tediousness. When we inspect an element, we can change everything about it and its CSS. The specific element is highlighted in the web view and changes are applied instantly. This is an amazing tool for debugging CSS and HTML related bugs. Every value within the inspector can be edited. We can also add new attributes and instantly examine their impact. This lets us experiment rapidly while tuning the actual code based on results. One of the biggest problems developers run into is the specificity issue. The specificity issue is the situation in which changes we make to the CSS aren't applied. This can happen if a more specific selector is overriding the attributes we're trying to set. We can detect this when inspecting an element's CSS. We would see our setting is in strikeout mode and could scroll up to see the attribute that overrode our setting. Once we understand the specific cause, we can edit our CSS rules to address that problem. This is still the tip of the front-end debugging iceberg. In the next video, we'll discuss front-end logging, which is very different from backend. If you have any questions, please use the Slack channel to ask them. Thank you.